family and friends, we are gathered here to say our final farewells to Papa, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew. After the formalities of the lying in state and the state funeral service, in this final hour, Papa is with his family, his friends of a lifetime, his immediate staff who served him loyally and well, his security team who kept him safe and sound, and his medical team who took such good care of him. So much has been said about Papa in his public life in the past few days. His public life is something we share with all of Singaporeans and with the world. But we were privileged to know him as a father, a grandfather, an elder brother, a friend, a strict but compassionate boss, the head of the family. Actually, Papa was the head of two families. Because as the eldest son, from a young age, he was effectively head of his household, helping his mother, Ma, to bring up his younger brothers and sister. He remained close to them all his life. To my uncles and aunts, he was always Gore, never Harry. Say so, Uncle Swan Yu would have him over to dinner every Christmas. And Kuche, Auntie Monica, would cook him his favorite dishes and teach his cook how to do them, almost to the same standard as hers. Papa made it a point to attend the Chinese New Year reunions of the extended Lee family every year, even till last year, to catch up with his siblings, to meet his nephews and nieces, and later his grandnephews and grandnieces. I think there are a few great-grandnephews and nieces, but I'm not sure they have met yet. Pa was also head of his own family, my mother and the three of us. He had plunged deeply into politics by the time we arrived. In fact, the day I was born, when he visited Mama and the new baby in Kandang Kerbau Hospital, instead of talking about the new baby, he told her how he was going to represent the postmen's union in their dispute with the government. This was the postman's strike, which first made his name and launched him into active politics. So, day to day, Mama ran the household, brought us up, saw to our schooling, but Papa set the tone, tracked our progress, and made the big decisions. He sent us to a Chinese school. He started us on Malay lessons with Cikgu Amin and his wife Cikgu Jamila. He encouraged Yang and me to take up SAF scholarships to serve the nation. He persuaded Ling to become a doctor instead of a vet. He set us on the path to make our own marks on the world, and we are grateful. We are also grateful that Papa guided and nurtured us to grow up into normal, well-adjusted people, even though we were the Prime Minister's children. Always in the spotlight and in every danger of being spoilt, indulged, and led astray. He and Mama decided that we would stay in Oxley Road and not move to Sri Temasek, lest we grow up thinking that the world owed us a living. He made sure we did not get the wrong ideas, no inflated sense of self, never to be inconsiderate to others, not to throw our weight around. We may not always have done it right, but we were never left in any doubt as to what was the right way to behave. He took pride in us children. When I learned to ride a bicycle, he was there. Once, when I was just getting the hang of balancing on two wheels, he pushed me off from behind to get me started. And I pedaled off across the field, thinking that he was still behind supporting and pushing me. And after a few seconds, I turned around and I found I was on his own and launched. And he had let go. He was so pleased, and so was I. Like all good fathers, Papa continued to be there for us even after we grew up. When Yang and I got married, he wrote us long and thoughtful letters, sharing advice on how to make our marriages successful. Precious lessons drawn from his own long and very happy marriage with Mama. After Ming Yang died, and especially before I remarried, he and Mama spent time with our two little children, Siu Qi and Yipeng, then still infants, to fill the gap and to help to bring them up. They took them for walks after dinner every night in the Istana. He was not an indulgent grandfather, but a loving one. There's a photo of Papa with four grandsons, who were then toddlers, blowing soap bubbles in the garden in front of Sri Temasek. When I was undergoing chemotherapy for lymphoma, Papa once rang up all the way from the Philippines. He was on some official trip. He rang back. I thought it was some important matter of state. Turned out, he called to say he had arranged to send me some durians. He wanted to make sure I was properly nourished during my chemotherapy. Papa was happy that all three children grew up to be successful and responsible people, contributing to society in our different ways. A few months after I became Prime Minister, he wrote me a letter on his minister mentor letterhead. I think it may be the only letter I ever received from him on that letterhead. And it read, "These are mock-ups of my Christmas and New Year cards for the year 2005. The photograph after the swearing-in at the Istana records a memorable evening in my life. Have you any amendments or comments?" The photo was of me shaking hands, congratulating him, I as the new Prime Minister, and he as the new Minister Mentor, and the President, Mr. S.R. Nathan, looking on. Naturally, I replied that I agreed and that I had no amendments. He was proud of his son, but he wanted to do things in the proper way, as always. He continued to teach us lessons in life into his later years. We learned from him, watching him grow old with Mama. She meant the world to him and he to her. They delighted in each other's company. After Mama's stroke in 2003, he nursed her back to health, encouraged her to exercise and stay active, and continued to take her on trips abroad. He even learned to measure her blood pressure using a traditional sphygmomanometer and a stethoscope, and faithfully did this twice a day, every day, and emailed the results to her doctors. He would tell her, "Life is an endless series of adjustments. As you grow older, you adjust. Think how lucky we are and how much worse off we could be. Always look on the bright side of things." Mama's passing 5 years ago was a huge blow to him. But the pictures of them together kept Papa company to remind him of their 63 happy years together. All his life, Papa kept up with his old friends, Yong Pang Hao, Jia Chui Leong, Hon Sui Sen, and after Sui Sen passed away, his widow Annie and the children. As the years went by, the numbers of his old friends dwindled. In recent years, he'd occasionally host dinners for his tutors, his doctors, his staff and friends. Usually at the Raffles Hotel, courtesy of Jenny Chua, in order to stay in touch and to show his appreciation. And every fortnight or so, Kim Lee, his niece on my mother's side, would take him out for meals and for a change of surroundings. And they'd go out to different places, Underwater World, Sentosa, Changi Airport to see Project Jewel, to take a boat ride in the harbour. He enjoyed the outings and the company. And a few other friends would join in and take turns to host him. Wai Kiong, Stephen, Ong Beng Seng, Man Leong, Peter Sia, Robert Ng, among others. We are grateful to Kim Lee and to them. I would also like to thank the medical team of doctors, nurses, physiotherapists, specialists of all kinds, led by Professor Fong Kok Yong, for taking such good care of my father. You have been competent, dedicated, and compassionate. Papa used to say his father lived till 94, his mother till 73, so if he made it to the average of these two ages, he would count himself lucky. And after that, every year would be a bonus. Papa was lucky to have such a great medical team taking care of him. And he enjoyed many bonus years. And we were lucky to enjoy him for many bonus years too. For many years, Yang has made it a custom to host family gatherings, a dinner at his home on my parents' birthdays. On Papa's 90th birthday, we had our usual cozy meal. I was taking pictures at the dinner table. Papa gave a radiant smile. I decided to soak in the moment and not grab my camera and scramble to capture the photo. So I don't have a photo, but I have a memory which will be there forever. Thank you to the SecCom team who have protected my father. You not only ensured his security, but were always by his side, round the clock, beyond the call of duty. You became friends and almost part of the family. Thanks particularly to the SOs who served as coffin bearers just now for carrying my father today on his last journey. And also to the pallbearers here at Mandai, who are the SOs, doctors and nurses, for doing my father this honor. Thank you also to Papa's personal staff, especially Lin Ho and YY, who have served him for more than 20 years each. Lin Ho, his private secretary, helped to take care of my father in the office. YY did much more than would be expected of a press secretary. She made the video which you saw earlier before the service started, and it was a labor of love. I would also like to thank my sister Ling, who lived with Papa on Oxley Road and who did so much to help take care of him. You were not only his daughter, but also his doctor, one of them. You were his close companion throughout. You traveled with him, watched over him closely, made sure he got medical treatment in time when problems were brewing and before any disaster could happen. You took on more than your fair share of our filial duties. Thank you, Ling. Finally, I want to thank the dedicated grassroots volunteers from Tek Gee and Tanjung Pagar. You've served for many years on the ground, helping Mr. Lee and me to look after our residents. Over this last week, you've helped take care of arrangements and guests at the private wake at Sri Temasek, as well as a state funeral service and this cremation service today. My family and I are deeply grateful. When we are young, we think our parents will always be there. After we grow up, as we watch them age and grow frail, we know rationally that one day we will have to say farewell. Yet emotionally, we find it hard to imagine it happening. Then, one day, our parents are really gone. And so we are left with a sense of loss and a deep pain. And that's the human condition. Papa had thought long and hard about this, as he had about many things. When preparing what I'd say to you today, I remembered that once upon a time, he had made a speech about growing old and dying to a gathering of doctors. I asked for it. Nobody else remembered it except Janadas. So that gave me confidence that I had not imagined it. We searched for the speech, and eventually, after a heroic effort, YY found it. Baba had made it to a congress of cardiologists very long ago. In fact, in 1972, 43 years ago. I must have read it at the time, and it left such an impression on me that I remembered it across four decades. Or it could be I'm just growing old and remembering long ago things. I reread the speech with delight. It was vintage Lee Kuan Yew. Thoughtful, erudite, elegant, witty, but with a deeper point. Sadly, nobody makes such after-dinner speeches like that anymore. He titled it, "Life is Better When It's Short, Healthy and Full." He talked about cardiac health, decrepitude, the right to die, advanced medical directives, even though the term had not yet been invented, and much more. You have to read the full speech yourselves because it's impossible to summarize, and it is well worth reading. But I will just share with you one quote. "Life is better short, healthy, and full than long, unhealthy, and dismal. We all have to die. I hope mine will be painless. As de Gaulle said, never fear, even de Gaulle must die." And he did. Papa had a long and full life. He was healthy, active, and vigorous until advanced old age. He used to say that life is a marathon, not a sprint. Papa's marathon is done. He went away peacefully. He will leave a big hole in our lives and in our hearts. But his values, his love, and his words, these will stay with us, inspire us, and live on in us for a long, long time. Farewell, and rest in peace, Baba.